fund from modern courts acted in bad faith. Glendora resigned because it took so much time, because Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath were so dilatory, were so rude, and were so unproductive, and were not accomplishing anything. Further, they were obsequious to the judges. The judges all got scores over 95. It is, as I have said, a scam. And you know what these judges do? They romance the monitors. They call the monitors to the chambers and talk to them nicely. And the monitors think that's a big honor to be called to the chambers. And so the whole thing is crooked. The judges are crooked, and the Fund for Modern Courts is crooked, along with Hubbard, Beck, and Mayapath. We will do more for court reform than they ever did. They are imposters. This is one thing. Another is that they defy court practices, laws, and rules. Yes, a court reform association defies court practice, laws, and rules. CPLR. Purvis. I believe it was in July, Elizabeth Hubbard, the executive director, had politely told her, "We really don't need your services anymore as a volunteer, and thank you very much for what you have done." Glendora, this is histrionics, and it never happened. This is $200 per hour quality, Judge Colabella. And based on what Mrs. Hubbard had told me, I made a motion for summary judgment, did the research for looking up the cases when volunteers had ever brought suit on a contract theory of action. I had to spend a bit of time reading her complaint to make sure that I was answering each allegation correctly, because she would contradict herself in the same sentence. Glendora, when volunteers had been double-crossed by bad faith court reform association, is that a record to be proud of, defendant's lawyer, friend, judge? What do you conclude God thinks of this? Purvis, I had to spend a bit of time, unquote, he's a slow reader, a slow worker, and a slow thinker. His value is not $200 per hour. Further, his friend only asked him to help her out, asked him to volunteer. Hubbard asks Purvis to volunteer. Hubbard gets paid, but she rests on the work and labor of everybody else. She's always asking people to volunteer. Glendora never contradicted herself in the same sentence, nor in any sentence, and has already refuted the same in her cross motion, which Judge Colabella never did his homework on and read. Purvis, and one part of that, because the suit was frivolous, I was to be awarded, or my firm was to be awarded, attorney's fees upon showing an affirmation of services of the work. Glendora, there was nothing frivolous about Glendora's suit. She sought justice for people who disreputably went back on their word, then lied about it, and then tried to cover up. She relied to her detriment on their no good word. Note, Colabella has already decided, hearing or not, to take care of his friend Purvis. Here is a question. Do Colabella, Mallon, Kellner, Powell get any part of this $4,500, to which Colabella said, "I'll sign"? And on page 10, Purvis says, "And I bill my corporate clients, which is most of my work, at the rate of $200 an hour." Glendora is not a corporate account. She and Franklin are poor senior citizens, 66 and 76, living on Social Security and Franklin's pension check from 37 years as a newspaper reporter. Glendora has no income from her business anymore, Glendora TV ads, because the time it requires went into Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, Fund for Modern Courts, as a volunteer masquerading as court reformers, and then given to seek justice in a biased and prejudiced and crooked court. Purvis still, on page 10, "And I am sure, even though from seeing the voluminous pleadings, they can't be answered yes, no, you have to take a little time with them to do them justice, and I felt particularly so as she is appearing pro se, and I don't want to have anything slip past. I wanted to make sure she understood it all, and that the court did, and that is pretty much what I have, Glendora." Yes, the voluminous pleadings of hours, sweat, tears, sleepless nights that went totally unread by Judge Colabella. Purvis never did do them justice. He acted like a child from the beginning. He let everything slip past. As a pro se, Glendora received brutality and never any leniency as required by the law. It was Purvis who never understood it all, quote unquote. At $200 per hour, he should have comprehended a whole lot better than he did. And the court doesn't care about understanding anything. The court is just looking for a weapon to vent spite and malice because Glendora refused to be pushed around by these disqualified brutes. Purvis. Since that time, I know this case has been noticed several times. I got calls from Glendora saying she is going to be on cable TV in the various channels and the hours. She is going to be naming me in the Fund for Modern Courts by name. Glendora, as a courtesy, notifies people when reports about them are going to be on TV. That last part was Purvis. This is Glendora saying this. In the case of Purvis, Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, masquerading as a court reform association, Glendora left the information on telephone answering machines since she cannot tolerate speaking to these liars, thieves, and cheats and degenerates. Purvis, page 11 of the minutes continued. I am now known as Mr. Perverted Purvis in the eyes of the law, and it's the Fund for Ancient Courts and other worse terms. I unfortunately don't get them on my channel. Colabella, so your request is 22 and a half hours at $200 an hour. Purvis, this is correct. Colabella, all right, thank you very much. You can step down, sir. Witness excuse. Colabella, the court credits the testimony of Mr. Purvis. Statement of the century. The court credits the testimony of Mr. Purvis. Remember, it's all hearsay. A member of the firm of Clifford, Gelban, and Purvis, and one of them isn't even there anymore, attorneys for the defendant. Glendora, the court would credit it. Judge Colabella would. It was all pre-decided. It was premeditated injustice. Let's go over that again. It was premeditated injustice. Judge Colabella, on page 12 of the minutes, I find that he, that meaning Purvis, has expended 22 and a half hours in defending this case. Do you find that, folks? Mm-hmm. On what basis do you find that, Judge Colabella? Where's the proof? Colabella says, at a minimum, including the preparation of an answer, interrogatories, motion for summary judgment, other motions, reading the file, talking to the various parties, research, etc. Judge Colabella says, in his crooked way. Glendora, oh yes, where are the witnesses to the same? Where is the documentation? I'm asking you this. Where is the log of hours, dates, and what was done at those hours and on those dates? Did Purvis submit anything like that? No, nothing. He submitted no documentation at all. He just did what Colabella told him to do, stand up and say. And it's all hearsay. Where are the affidavits? Where are the receipts? Purvis doesn't even sign it, not even notarized, not verified. Interrogatories, quote unquote, are not allowed in personal injury discovery, Judge Colabella, CPLR Article 31, etc. is pretty vague, Judge Colabella. The gig is up, Judge Colabella. Judge Colabella on page 2 says, I find that the time expended is fair and I find that the $200 an hour is reasonable. Do you believe that in the Westchester County Supreme Court? Do you believe that? That lie? That sham? That cover-up? Manipulation? Contrivance? Glendora finds Judge Colabella unfair and unreasonable. Judge Colabella continued on page 12 of the minutes, therefore I award attorney's fees in the amount of 200 times 22 and a half hours, which is Purvis, $4,500. Why don't you learn to multiply, Judge Colabella? Glendora, Purvis puts the words in Judge Colabella's mouth again, and Judge Colabella puts the words in Purvis' mouth. Judge Colabella continues on page 12, $4,500 to be fair and reasonable. You crook. The court has dismally failed to be fair and reasonable since the court double-crossed Glendora, went back on its words to Glendora, just as Hubbard, Beck, and Mayapath did. Judge Colabella on page 12 continues, and if you will submit a judgment with that amount of money as attorney's fees, I will sign it. The record is there. I know what you are thinking. Purvis, thank you very much, Your Honor. Colabella, okay. Glendora, the record speaks for itself. The minutes of March 6, 1995 conclude, "We conclude these proceedings at 2:55 p.m. The record should reflect that Glendora did not appear. Certified to be a true and correct transcript of minutes in this case to the best of my ability, Kevin Malone, getting $65, $5 a page for an empty page." Glendora, "The record does not reflect that it is Judge Colabella's fault that Glendora did not appear. At 11 a.m. on the day that Mallon called, Glendora's time from 2 to 5 p.m. that afternoon was already scheduled. Further, Glendora needed more than 3 hours to review a case Judge Colabella had allowed to languish from October 1944 to March 1995. The voluminous pleadings, quote unquote, remember, by admission." And that actually happened. That happened here on this earth, in the state of New York, in the county of Westchester, in the city of White Plains. The whole record of a crooked judge, along with all the other crooked actors. "A consumer has a right to bid for services, don't you think, and get the lowest bid? Judge Colabella has no right to throw a price of $200 at Glendora and give her no choice, let alone no hearing. And I object to the quality of that $200. He's not up to that quality. I don't think any lawyer is. You can't find anybody greedier and grubbier and more avaricious than lawyers. Since when did all this thing start, $200 an hour? How do we know that their hour is worth $200, even worth two, even $10 an hour? It is all lies. Purvis has lied all along, as have Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, Mallon, Kellner, and Powell. Lies, deceit, and deception. Purvis had to be desperate to take a case like that, a desperation he has demonstrated ever since. But he knew he could count on the courts being crooked. Here are five so-called grown men, Judge Colabella, Thomas Mallon, Stephen Kellner, Raymond Powell, and Edmund Purvis picking on one woman. Isn't that manhood in its splendor? Five grown men picking on a female senior citizen of age 67 on Social Security. Five bullies. Wouldn't one have been enough? Isn't $4,500 attorney's fees pretty high for representing a friend, quote unquote? Aren't your eyes blinded by the explosion of vengeance, vindictiveness, and grubby greed? And this is from an association masquerading as court reform. Remember, Purvis called this a court of equity, quote unquote, and courts of equity were abolished by the CPLR way, way, way back. Is such nescience worth $200 per hour? Judge Colabella used Purvis as a weapon against Glendora. Judge Colabella used Purvis as a weapon against Glendora. But greedy, grubby Purvis is exuberant. Thank you very much, Your Honor. Page 12 of the minutes. He was glad to be their paid too and their paid liar. Glendora was entitled to costs when she won the Cablevision case in Judge Silverman's court, but Judge Silverman enjoined her from getting them. She has received nothing from the $2.5 billion Cablevision. We have been stripped of our courts, people. Nothing is left but the rubble. See the rubble. There are no courts. We have been stripped of courts. Only rubble remains. If we had good judges in Westchester County Supreme Court, the public would not end up hating them, and we would not have to spend all that time and something, all that delay being frisked. Oh yeah, all that time and all that delay being frisked by rude New York State court officers and having our privacy violated as they go through our handbags and our briefcases, all because crooked judges want to cover up how bad they are. These courts are our courts, they are open to the public, and we shouldn't have to be putting away our videotape cameras and our audio recorders. Purvis claims he spent 22 and a half hours and he is as slow as a snail. This is how Glendora was cheated out of a default judgment. His work product looks like 2.5 hours. See the rubble. There are no courts. We have been stripped of courts. Only rubble remains. If we had good judges in Westchester County Supreme Court, the public would not end up hating them, and we would not have to spend all that time and something, all that delay being frisked, oh yeah, all that time and all that delay being frisked by rude New York State court officers and having our privacy violated as they go through our handbags and our briefcases, all because crooked judges want to cover up how bad they are. These courts are our courts, they are open to the public, and we shouldn't have to be putting away our videotape cameras and our audio recorders. Purvis claims he spent 22 and a half hours and he is as slow as a snail. This is how Glendora was cheated out of a default judgment. His work product looks like 2.5 hours. And Glendora is a woman who volunteered her time, labor, and money, and is ordered to pay $4,500 for doing so. This is the sham that Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, and the Fund for Modern Courts is. What do Glendora and Franklin get paid for 200 hours of hard work and time standing up to liars, thieves, and cheats? Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, and the Fund for Modern Courts. What do they get paid fighting the evil of the Colabella Court? Glendora gets paid the same as Socrates did and is the same as Jesus Christ did. Because of self-serving judges like Colabella and Silverman, courts are not a solution anymore. We have been stripped of our courts. All that remains is a pile of rubble. Courts have been turned into power abusers by your dishonors, by lawyers converting the courts into an industry to make as much money as they can, by politicians who violate every canon of the judicial code. Sing the 9X song, we're all connected. Supposing Hubbard, Beck, and Mayapath had to pay attorney's fees, would their friend Purvis have charged them $4,500? So where do you go when judges break the laws, codes, and rules? Is it probable that Judge Colabella will face up to his egotism, recklessness, selfishness, violation of oath, laws, rules, and codes, face up to them and repent and make good? Where do you go when the judge and his clerks are worse than the defendants? When the judge and his clerks are worse than the defendants and their lying lawyer? Do you go to the Commission on Judicial Conduct? They are afraid of the Westchester politicos. Gerald Stern would lose his appointment. Gerald Stern would lose his appointment if he dared tamper with the political power of the Westchester Supreme Court. Nevertheless, Glendora will send this to Stern, who will be soft. Stern is soft. In an honest court, Glendora could move, A, that Judge Colabella vacate the March 6, 1995 so-called hearing, that Glendora be given a hearing, that it be a hearing with at least 2 weeks' notice to permit preparation, that Judge Colabella recuse himself for his violation of oath and duty, his vindictiveness, his spite, and his malice, that his retinue of Mallon, Kellner, and Powell recuse for the same reasons, that Purvis be sanctioned for taking from March the 6, 1995 to June the 9th, 1995 to send Glendora the minutes, the judgment, the bill of costs, and the letter to the court exposing the collusion between court, defendants, and Purvis. If Glendora made such a motion, we all know what would happen. A, denied. B, attorney's fees. C, costs. We are stripped of our courts. All that remains is a pile of rubble. Will Judge Colabella sign the judgment June 21st, 1995, the summer solstice? Or will he be man enough and Christian enough to face himself, repent, and atone? If he signs the judgment, Glendora will move the appellate division to vacate it, pursuant to CPLR 5704, review of ex parte orders. For $200 per hour, Purvis is devoid of citations, case law, and CPLR. Judge Colabella did the same thing to Glendora he did to Doris Sassauer, along with his other faults. Apparently, he is a misogynist. These minutes had no cover and were not bound. $65, no cover and not bound, Kevin Malone. Glendora was up Sunday night, June the 11th, 1995, from 9 p.m. to 4 a.m. because of the fiendish Purvis and Judge Colabella. She slept 1 hour, from 4 a.m. to 5 a.m., Then Tuesday night, June 13, Glendora was up from midnight to 5 a.m. She slept from 10 p.m. to midnight. The total time it took Glendora and Franklin to oppose this injustice was June 11th, 1 hour, June the 13th, 7 1/2 hours, June the 14th, 14 hours, and the total is 22 1/2 hours. Glendora is sure she spent more time than that, but she thought 22 1/2 hours is a reasonable figure to end on. Well, it was 26 hours, plus 2 hours reporting it on television, plus 2 more hours to edit it. Wherefore, pages 1 through 46 do state sufficient reasons why this court should vacate its action of 1995, quote unquote, hearing, so-called. B, this court should grant Glendora a hearing. C, with proper notice of the hearing in writing of no less than 2 weeks. D, Judge Colabella should recuse himself as no longer qualified to handle anything in this case. Thomas Mallon, Stephen Kellner, and Raymond Powell should remove themselves from this case because of being disqualified by spite and malice. This court should strike from the bill of costs the $65 stenographer fees. This court should grant Glendora her costs and disbursements. This court should grant Glendora any other relief that is fit and proper. Notice that I don't say that this court deems fit and proper, because this court doesn't do anything fit and proper. Dated White Plains, New York, June the 14th, 1995, Flag Day. Some flag, some Americanism, these people have shown. And then I'll name them. Hubbard, Beck, Mayapath, Colabella, Kellner, Mallon, Mallon, Powell, Purvis. Some Americans they are. Yours in truth, Glendora, Abuse Court Monitor, Box 416, White Plains, New York, 10602. And here are the exhibits. We have Center for Judicial Accountability. We have Glendora's case against Cablevision, the appeal that she won in the Second Circuit, United States Court of Appeals. We have Kai Clear and one of his form letters and do nothing, Commission on Judicial Conduct. Statement of Purpose, Center for Judicial Accountability. Open Membership Meeting and Alert, Center for Judicial Accountability. May 1st Law Day Demonstration launches petition drive. Petition. We the people hereby petition Governor George Pataki to appoint a state commission to investigate and hold public hearings on judicial corruption and the political manipulation of judgeships in the state of New York. You know what this is actually saying? This $4,500. Don't you ever dare, ever, go to the Westchester County Supreme Court looking for justice again. That's what it's saying. Now then, we're going to read you the minutes of the Glendora versus Michael Gelman trial on February the 23rd, 1995. And what's the story on Michael Gelman? Glendora sent Michael Gelman 2 videotapes, VHS, and he never returned them. He has no respect for anybody else's property. He did nothing but rationalize and defend his, well, it's really stealing is what it comes down to. And he paid a lawyer a whole lot of money, or ABC did, or Cap Cities did. And these are the minutes of the trial. On the last two programs, we read you pages 1 up to 50 of the minutes. Today, we're starting out, and we're going to read you page 51 to 52. And these minutes, look at them. Yeah. So hard to read. I don't know why Lisa Kaplan does it that way. Look, That's hard to read. It's carbon. It's carbon, and it's a bad carbon. You know, why didn't you type them out and then make a copy on a Xerox machine or a Canon or something? Maybe if I stick this white paper behind it, I can read them better to you. No, it's still hard, and it's so faint. And I paid $400 for this. I sued Michael Gelman for $380. I haven't got it yet, and so far I've spent $400 on the minute. I've spent over $550 on Michael Gelman. I've spent over 700 hours on Michael Gelman's lack of ethics and lack of principle and his covering up and his dishonesty. Okay, page 51. Is it not true, Mrs. Buell, DiGiulio says, that the litigation that you are involved in is discussed on these programs which find their way onto public access TV? Glendora, I object to that. DiGiulio, yes or no? Glendora, I object to it. This is not pertinent to the case at bar. DiGiulio, yes or no? Glendora, I object to that. I have an objection. Mr. DiGiulio, if your honor will hear argument. Judge, make an offer of proof. Mr. DiGiulio, it is our contention that we would like to develop additional materials which Mrs. Buell uses on her public access television shows to bring attention to herself and Glendora. That is a lie. That is a lie. He knows not whereof he speaks. That is a lie. DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, have you not? Glendora, wait a second. My answer to that is that my television show should be about higher things, and at the moment, we are reporting what we see happen in the courts, what we see judges do, what we see lawyers do, what we see people's courts do. We are reporting that, as under the Cable Act of 1984, to inform the public and to stimulate public debate. As far as my personal shows, as to what my program would be about, it not about people that break the law, of which Michael Gelman is one. That is not my choice. This is not taken down correctly, even coherently. DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, yes or no, have you not discussed at length on several of your broadcasts materials that find their way over the public access TV show channel? Glendora, first of all, DiGiulio, if I may finish the question. Glendora, I wish you would finish it. Mr. DiGiulio, your honor. DiGiulio, you asked such a lengthy and convoluted question. I said that to the judge. The materials that that telecast over the public access channels to which you have access, did they include on several occasions discussions concerning this lawsuit, yes or no? I am a public access producer. I submit my programs to the cable company. That's one answer, yes. The other answer, did it include discussions? No. There is no discussion. I am the only person on the program. It is a report. DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, Glendora, it is a report, not a discussion. DiGiulio, are you finished with your answer? Glendora, no, I am not. There is a third thing in there that was wrong. DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, Judge, Mr. DiGiulio, can't you move on? DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, how many current separate pieces of litigation are you currently involved in? Glendora, I object to that, Your Honor. It is not pertinent to the case at bar. DiGiulio, Mrs. Buell, may I have an answer? Mr. DiGiulio, Your Honor, I would like an answer to the question. Mr. DiGiulio says, these are not good minutes. Mr. DiGiulio, Your Honor, I would like an answer to the question, and they cost $400. Judge, Mr. DiGiulio, how is this pertinent to the case? Mr. DiGiulio, Your Honor, this individual has a number of actions pending. It is something of an avocation. Glendora, object. Mr. DiGiulio, it is something she does to occupy herself. Glendora, objection. Mr. DiGiulio, and I believe it is relevant. Glendora, I object. Judge, you will have to narrow the question then. If there are any other cases related to this case or a related nature, but not generally, whether there are other cases related. Glendora, shall I answer? Judge, there is no question before you, ma'am. Do you want to rephrase the question? DiGiulio, I have nothing further, Your Honor. Judge, okay, cross-examination is finished. Now, if you want to add anything, you may, Mrs. Buell. Glendora, well, all right. Your Honor, please tell me when I can call my witness. The judge, as soon as you are finished saying that you have to say about anything that you want. Glendora, this isn't my closing statement, is it? Judge, no. Glendora, what do I want to add to that? I would like to draw judicial attention to the fact that there are fight for rights. They are not my personal choice for program content, okay? Judge, okay. Glendora, no, judge again. Do you have any witnesses that you would like to call? Glendora, myself, yes. I would like to call my husband, Franklin Buell, and Franklin is spelled with a Y. Court stenographer. Judge, Mr. Buell, please step up here and raise your right hand. Franklin Buell, called as a witness in behalf of the claimant herein, having first been duly sworn by the court, testified as follows. The judge, you may be seated. Please give me your full name and home address. Franklin, F-R-A-N-K-L-Y-N, Buell, B-U-E-L-L. You know, that's all wrong. He didn't say B-U-E-L, he said B-U-E-L-L. Box 416, White Plains, New York, 10602. Judge, Mrs. Buell, you may ask your husband questions. Direct examination by Mrs. Buell. Question, do you feel up to this? Husband, sure. Glendora, do you feel all right? Franklin, yes. Glendora, Mr. Buell, did Glendora place a telephone call to Michael Gelman on or about Christmas 1989? Buell, Franklin, yes, she did. Glendora, and would you please tell the court what question Glendora asked Mr. Gelman? Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. The witness would have to know, have no way of knowing who is on the other end of the phone. Judge, she can't say anything. Would you rephrase your question and say, what did you hear Glendora ask? We have no way of knowing who was on the other end of the phone. You may ask what you asked that way. Glendora, what question did Glendora ask Mr. Gelman? Judge, no, not Mr. Gelman. Glendora, what question did you hear Glendora ask? Judge, Franklin. I heard her ask or say that she told jokes and likes to cheer people up and that she had been on the David Letterman show and on CNBC and that she would like to have jokes considered for Live with Regis, thinking that perhaps that would help cheer up the audience or for Live with Regis, and I know it was Mr. Gelman on the other end of the phone. Mr. DiGiulio, objection. Glendora. Franklin, because she had it on the speakerphone and I had heard the whole conversation. Judge, sir, you have to keep your voice low. Franklin continued, "She had it on the speakerphone and I heard the whole conversation. I heard what Mr. Gelman said to Glendora. Judge, you may ask the next question. Glendora, did Glendora offer to send a videotape to Mr. Gelman? Glendora, yes, she did. Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor." See, he's getting too close to the truth for DiGiulio, the liar. Glendora, Mr. Buell, who was on the other end of the telephone? Mr. DiGiulio, objection. Answer by Franklin Buell. Michael Gelman, the producer of Live of Regis, which is carried on Channel 7 and CNBC Network. The judge, Mr. Buell, you are only supposed to answer the question. Have you ever personally spoken to Mr. Gelman before? Whereupon there was no response from the witness. You, sir, pointing. Franklin, no, no. Judge, do you know his voice? Franklin, no, but she asked for Michael Gelman and he said, this is Michael Gelman. Judge, so the person answered purported to be Michael Gelman? Franklin, that's right. Judge, go ahead, we have no way of knowing. Crooked, you heard Glendora say, Michael Gelman? Franklin, yes. Glendora, and did the other voice say yes? Franklin, yes. Ah, it's thin paper. Why didn't you make a Xerox copy? Judge, proceed. Glendora, how long would you say that conversation endured? Franklin, I would say about a minute and a half, possibly 2 minutes. Glendora, and was a videotape sent to Mr. Gelman? Glendora, Franklin, yes. You asked him the question and he said, Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. The question was whether a videotape was sent to Mr. Gelman. Judge, just answer the question. That's the rule. Franklin, yes. Glendora, about when was a videotape sent to Mr. Gelman? Franklin, it was sent within a few days. Glendora, and how was it sent? Franklin, it was sent by UPS. Glendora, did you place any telephone calls to Mr. Gelman? Franklin, yes, I did. What did you say in those telephone calls? Well, in the beginning, we tried to get Michael Gelman to the phone and to ask him what had happened, but when it became apparent that he was never going to answer the phone, DiGiulio, please note my objection, Your Honor. Franklin, we began talking to other people that did answer, some of whom made revealing remarks. DiGiulio, Your Honor, I object. Judge, the court will not entertain any revealing remarks. Constantly, this judge, who was Mary Lee, Sarah Lee Evans, constantly, she covered up the evidence, constantly. No logs, no audio tapes, no remarks telling what happened, giving the story of the case. Glendora, no revealing remarks. Franklin, as I said, he would never come to the phone, so we can have no testimony by him, only have testimony by people in his office. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. See, DiGiulio, objection to everything. Cover-up, liar, paid liar. Glendora, Mr. Buell, did you on these telephone calls ever ask for Michael Gelman to come to the phone? Did you ever ask to speak to him? Franklin, each time. Glendora, did he ever come to the phone? Franklin, no. Glendora, did you leave messages? Franklin, yes. Glendora, in general, can you say what these messages were? Franklin, well, in the early stages it was, did he send the tape and what was the answer and what did he think? As time went on, the request was to tell Mr. Gelman that we had called, and then as time went on, really, then the message was, would you please tell Mr. Gelman that we would like $120 for the videotape that he lost, apparently, and never returned. Glendora, what is your feeling as to these messages relayed to Mr. Gelman? DiGiulio, note my objection, Your Honor. Glendora, I will withdraw the question if you object. I can ask him what his feelings were. Judge, you can't ask about feelings. You can only ask about what he saw or observed. Glendora, all right. Did Mr. Gelman or anybody in his office ever return a videotape? Franklin, never. Glendora, did anybody in Mr. Gelman's office say that they had returned the tape? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection, Your Honor. Answer, Franklin, yes. Glendora, you can't say that either? Judge, because it is someone that is not in the court. That is the rule of evidence. Glendora, someone is talking for him, but he wouldn't say anything. Judge, Mr. Buell, if you are concerned procedures in this court, then you have to answer those procedures. It was Franklin who said, someone is talking for him, but he wouldn't say anything. And then the judge says, Mr. Buell, if you are concerned procedures in this court, then you have to observe those procedures. Now, the rule about hearsay is that you cannot give testimony of an out-of-court statement, either oral or in writing, made by a person who is not in court. The purpose is that the other side should be able to cross-examine a person, and you don't have the person here. Mr. Buell, that's true, yes. Judge, that is the purpose. I guess Glendora said that's true, yes. Judge Evans, that is the purpose. Glendora, that's true. Can I ask the court a question? Judge,
sure.
Glendora, why can't the court hear those statements with its own ears? Aha. Judge, because it doesn't matter if it's on a machine or if you are saying what a person said. I can't ask that tape a question. The other side can't ask that tape a question. You can't ask the tape a question. Suppose someone made a statement on a tape, all right, and you play me a statement on the tape, and it turns out to be the wrong tape, and it says something that you say. Oh my God, it's not the truth. And they didn't tell me that. So how are you going to say, is that really what you told me last week? There is no way to undo what you hear on tape. Glendora, how can the court not hear the evidence? Judge, but it's got to be evidence. That is called probative. It's got to be admissible, and more importantly, it has to be evidence that can be cross-examined in court. Would it be fair, for example, Mr. DiGiulio, to bring in a tape of what Mr. Norman said about you and be able to produce it for me without your being able to cross-examine Mr. Norman? That wouldn't be fair to you. Glendora, I wouldn't object. Judge, you might if he said something that you didn't like. Glendora, but Your Honor, I have brought my tapes to court so many times. Judge, was the person on the tape the person that was in court? For example, if you had a tape of Mr. Gelman saying to you, I swear to you, I will return the tape, then you can play that tape in court because he would be here and he would be able to be asked questions. Glendora, okay. Judge, do you understand what I'm saying? Glendora, I understand what you are saying. I say that a judge has to be an expert as to who is telling the truth and who is lying. Judge, that's what I am listening to now. Glendora, I will have to, therefore, rest my confidence in you. And that turned out to be a bad thing to do, rest my confidence in that judge, Sarah Lee Evans, upon your ability to discern whether I'm telling the truth. Judge, of course, I have no doubt that there were many phone calls made to Mr. Gelman's office and that many persons were spoken with and that many messages were left and Mr. Gelman did not come to the phone. I believe all those things. Glendora, thank you, Your Honor. Direct examination continued by Mrs. Buell. Mrs. Buell asks, Mr. Buell, is there anything else further that you would like to inform the court? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection, Your Honor. Judge, noted. Glendora, to the last question, no, it would hearsay. It would be things that people told me over the phone. And Franklin is really miffed, and I don't blame him, and so am I. Judge, okay. Glendora, it would be hearsay, so I can't say them. Judge, do you have any cross-examination? She said to DiGiulio. And DiGiulio chose not to cross-examine Franklin. Glendora, the court, thank you. Do you have any other witness? Mrs. Buell, yes, Michael Gelman. Judge, okay, would you please pass the Bible over to Mr. Gelman? Michael Gelman, called as a witness in behalf of the claimant herein, having first been duly sworn by the court, testified as follows. Judge, well, this court stenographer leaves out here that the recess was called so that DiGiulio could take Michael Gelman out into the hall and teach him how to lie better than he's been lying. Teach him not to say, I don't recall, to say over and over again, I don't recall, I don't recall, I don't recall, which is a lie. So the court doesn't say that. This court stenographer doesn't say that. Judge, please state your name and address for the record. Michael Gelman, 7 Lincoln Square, New York, New York. Judge, Mrs. Buell, you may proceed. Direct examination by Mrs. Buell. Mr. Gelman, did I ask you to look at my videotape? Calvin Norman asked me to look at your videotape, Gelman says. Mr. Gelman, did I ask you to look at my videotape? Gelman, no, and that's a lie. And Franklin and I know it to be a lie, and God knows it to be a lie. And you know it to be a lie, Michael Gelman. Glendora, did I talk to you, Mr. Gelman, on or about Christmas 1989? Mr. Gelman, I have no recollection of ever speaking with you. You know it's a lie, Michael Gelman. Your progeny knows it's a lie. God knows it's a lie. Franklin knows it's a lie. I know it's a lie. Do you have a recollection of anybody calling you on Christmas 1989 and asking to look at a videotape of jokes? No. DiGiulio told Gelman to lie. Of course he had a recollection. Glendora, do you have a good memory, Mr. Gelman? Gelman, it's okay. It's pretty good. Question, it's pretty good. Were you working in your office on Christmas Day, 1989? Gelman, probably not on Christmas, but I couldn't tell you for sure. It's a long time ago. Well, I can tell you for sure, Mr. Gelman, you were. Question, were you working in your office on Christmas Eve of 1989? Gelman, I usually take those holidays off. I couldn't tell you. Well, you didn't, Mr. Gelman. You were there, you answered the phone, and you spoke to me. And you said you were Michael Gelman. And you said you would look at the jokes. And I said I would send you a videotape of the jokes, and you said you would look at them. Glendora, you have no idea of what you were doing on Christmas 1989, whether you were working or not working? Gelman, what year was that? Glendora, 1989. Gelman, no. You said no to what? And in this decision, Sarah Lee Evans says that Gelman testified credibly. Glendora, you said no to what? Mr. DiGiulio, to your last question. Glendora, you have no idea whether you were working or not working on Christmas 1989. Gelman, no, I don't recall. DiGiulio taught him all that. Out in the hall, how to lie. Glendora, do you recall saying to Calvin Norman, I saw the videotape? Gelman, when Calvin Norman gave me a videotape, he said that it was from a client of his and asked if I would look at it, and as a favor to him, I did look at it, and yes, I told him I saw the videotape and I was not interested in using it. Glendora, is that all you told him about the videotape? Gelman, that's all I can recall telling him, yes. Glendora, in whose possession at that time was the videotape? Gelman, when I told him that, Glendora, yes. Gelman, it was in the office's possession. Glendora, in whose possession was the videotape at the time you told Calvin Norman that you just purported you told him? In whose possession was it? Mr. DiGiulio, you mean the name of the individual? Is that the question? You know, small claims is not a lawyer's turf. Small claims is for people who don't have lawyers. And you can see how the whole small claims concept and spirit is being abused here by Sarah Lee Evans and by DiGiulio. Glendora, in whose possession was it? Gelman, he gave it to me to view. Glendora, no, at the time you said to Calvin Norman, I saw the tape, I'm not interested in it. At that time, in whose possession was the tape? DiGiulio has to butt in. Your Honor, the witness already testified that it was in the possession of his office at that time. Is the question the name of the individual? Is that the question? Judge, are you asking who was physically holding the tape at that time, or was it, or where was it? Be specific. It could be in the possession of his office. If you want to know more specifically, if someone was actually holding it, or in the file, or something other than that, ask the specific question. In the possession of your office, is that the same thing as being in your possession? Who is in charge of your office? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection to the two questions asked. Mr. Gelman, who is in charge of your office? Judge, answer if you can. Gelman, I am in charge of my office. If the videotape was in the possession of your office, then it was in your possession. Is that so? Mr. DiGiulio, personal possession? Gelman, it's in the possession of my office. Judge, please move on. Was the videotape in your possession? Mr. DiGiulio, his personal possession? Judge, are you talking about physically? Mr. DiGiulio, his personal possession? Judge, was he holding it? Is that what you are saying? Asking Glendora. You mean holding it in his hand? Judge, yes, or in his desk drawer? just holding it. Miss Glendora, just holding it. Judge, were you holding it in your hand when you said that to Mr. Gelman? Witness, no. Gelman, no. Where was the videotape when you said that? Gelman, it was in possession of my office. Glendora, where was it? DiGiulio, physically, where was it? Is that the question? Gelman, I don't recall. Lie. Judge, why don't you say you don't recall? That would be easier. Now the judge is coaching. DiGiulio has coached Gelman to say, I don't know, I don't recall. And now the judge is coaching Gelman to say, I don't recall. Question, Glendora, you don't recall. Gelman, I don't know the exact possession of the videotape when I spoke to Mr. Norman. Glendora, you don't know who possessed the videotape. Did Calvin Norman possess the videotape at that time? Gelman, no. Glendora, when you saw the videotape that Calvin Norman gave you to look at, it was the first time you had seen Glendora doing that thing on the videotape? Gelman, yes. Glendora, are you under oath? Gelman, yes, I am. Glendora, how long was the tape? I don't recall, Gelman says. I keep hearing it was 10 minutes, but I don't recall. You don't recall, Glendora asks. Gelman, no. What did you see on the tape? This was many years ago, Gelman says, and I look at thousands of tapes all the time. Glendora, answer my question. What did you see on the tape? Gelman, you doing what? Doing some kind of performing? Glendora, what kind of performing? Gelman, I don't have any great recollection of it. Glendora, would you tell me anything that you do recall? Gelman, I recall, and DiGiulio butts in, because Gelman might speak the truth. DiGiulio, relevancy, Your Honor, I object. Judge, sustained. How do you think this is going? Which way do you think this is going? In the path of lies? In the path of cover-up? In the path of dishonesty? In the path of no ethics? Yeah, that's where it's going. DiGiulio, how is it relevant? Judge, too broad a question. Glendora, Your Honor, I just don't see how I can deal with a witness that doesn't recall anything. DiGiulio, he stated, Your Honor, he doesn't recall what was on the tape. Judge, he does remember looking at the tape, but he doesn't remember what was on the tape. Glendora, do you know what your Calvin... Glendora, do you know what year Calvin Norman asked you to look at that videotape? Gelman, only from hearing it in the court here, what year it was? No, 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 Glendora says. Do you remember what year it was? DiGiulio, he answered the question, Your Honor. Glendora, do you remember what year it was? Not from what you heard in the court, do you remember? Judge, do you have an independent recollection? Glendora, to the last question, if I hadn't heard it, Gelman. To the last question. If I hadn't heard it in the court proceeding, I wouldn't remember the year. It was a bunch of years ago. Glendora, does Calvin Norman still work on your floor? Gelman, no. Glendora, does Calvin Norman work in the same building with you? Gelman, yes. Glendora, when was the last time you saw Calvin Norman? Glendora, Gelman, probably a couple of months ago. Glendora, was Calvin Norman asked to be a witness at this trial? Gelman, I am not aware if he was or if he wasn't. Glendora, were there jokes on the videotape? Gelman, I think there were, yes. Glendora, what do you mean by telling Mr. DiGiulio in your affidavit that they were movie clips? What does that mean, movie clips? What are movie clips? Gelman, they were on your videotape, and as I said, I don't have great recollection of them. Glendora, what do you mean? Gelman, I look at thousands of tapes every year. Glendora, I didn't ask you that question. What do you mean by a movie clip? DiGiulio, Your Honor, is this all relevant to this case? Glendora, yes, it is relevant. In your affidavit, you stated that the videotape consisted of movie clips. What are movie clips? I don't know what movie clips is. DiGiulio, Your Honor, is this relevant to what is going on here today? Judge, it isn't. You see how this case is going? Glendora, I want to know what movie clips are. DiGiulio, objection to the question. Judge, Mrs. Buell, Glendora, he stated there is movie clips. The judge, he can state anything he wants. It has to be relevant to your claim that he didn't return your tape. Did you return my tape? And DiGiulio, objection to the form of the question, Your Honor. Glendora, did you return my videotape? DiGiulio, the question, did he personally return? Is that the question? Judge, did you personally return the videotape? Gelman, I personally did not. I asked an intern to send it back. Glendora, did an intern send it back? Gelman, I don't recall. Isn't it nice to lie your whole life through? Isn't that nice to have no ethics, to lie, and to have no ethics to return a person's property? Gelman, I don't recall. Glendora, yes or no? Gelman, I don't recall. DiGiulio, please answer the question. Gelman, I was told that they have. Glendora, do you have any proof that you returned the videotape, or that an intern returned the videotape, or that anybody returned the videotape? DiGiulio, objection to the form of the question. Do you have any proof, Glendora said, that a videotape was returned to me? Mr. DiGiulio, objection to the form. Glendora, wait a second, Your Honor. He is not the witness that I am questioning, meaning DiGiulio is not. He's the lawyer, and he shouldn't even be there. Judge, Mrs. Buell, please. Glendora, do you have any proof that you returned a videotape to me or anybody in your office returned a videotape to me? Judge, other than your testimony? Gelman, I am sorry. Judge, do you have any proof that the videotape was returned? Gelman, no, I do not, but I don't have any proof that it wasn't returned to you either. Judge, that wasn't asked of you. Glendora, do you think it is your ethical duty to return my videotape? DiGiulio, no, my objection, Your Honor. Judge, sustain. Glendora, why? Judge, because we are talking about a legal obligation that he made or may not have made, not an ethical obligation. Glendora, do you have a legal obligation to return my property? DiGiulio, note my objection to the form of the question. That is a question of law for the court. Judge, I understand. Glendora, what can I ask him then? Does he have a duty to me? Judge, no, I have to determine if he has a duty to you. You will testify. He sent it back. He said he didn't send it back. He asked someone to send it back or didn't ask someone to send it back. Then after that, I have to determine, based on your conversation, on all of the other things you have testified about, whether or not he had a legal obligation to personally return the tape to you. Glendora, you don't have to know whether he thinks or does not think he has a legal obligation to return it. Judge, even if he did think he did have a legal obligation, it is not relevant. The only issue is whether, under the law, he has the obligation, not whether he thinks or does not think. He is not a lawyer. He has no way of knowing. What his legal obligation is. Okay. Isn't that interesting? Look how old Gelman is, okay? And he doesn't even know whether he has a legal obligation to return a person's property. Bad. That's really bad. Where were his parents? You know, where was his religion to teach him this? Where was society to teach him this? You don't have a legal obligation to return another person's property. Pretty bad, Judge Sarah Lee Evans. Glendora, and you and I can't ask him if he thinks whether he thinks he has an ethical obligation. Judge, it is not relevant to the decision in the case. It might be very nice for you to ask, but it is not relevant to the decision, which is based on the law, which I told you at the beginning of this case that the decision would have to be made on the law. Well, naturally, it's got to be made on the law. Glendora, do you know Philip? Buth. DiGiulio, I'm sorry I didn't hear the question. Glendora, do you know Philip Buth? Gelman, yes I do. Glendora, how long have you known him? Glendora, well I have been at ABC now for 12 years. This is proud, a nice employee you have there at ABC. For 12 years, so sometime in that period, probably 10 or 12 years. Glendora, he didn't come there 12 years ago. Do you know what his duties are? DiGiulio, Your Honor, is this relevant? Judge, sustained. Now, is this relevant to your discussion and interaction, or lack thereof, with Mr. Gelman? Glendora, do you have any employment duty toward Philip Buth? Do you report to him? Gelman, no. Glendora, isn't he in charge of late night and early morning? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection, relevancy. Judge, Mrs. Buell, this is not relevant. Glendora, do you know Michael Katz? Gelman, yes. Glendora, first, before I leave Philip Buth, this is relevant. Did he ever speak to you about Glendora, Philip Buth? Katz, I have no recollection, Gelman, I have no recollection of ever hearing, having spoken to Philip Buth about Glendora. Glendora, do you know Michael Katz, or can't you recall that? Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor, to the form of the question. Glendora, do you know Michael Katz? Gelman, yes, I do. Glendora, did Michael Katz have your job before you got it? Gelman, not directly before, but yes, he had it before. Glendora, did he ever speak to you about Glendora? Gelman, I have no recollection of him ever speaking to me about Glendora. He has a pretty bad memory, don't you think? Or a very dishonest one. Glendora, will you please tell me what you mean by movie clips? DiGiulio, objection. We have been over that, Your Honor. Court, sustained. Do you have other objections to ask? Do you have other questions to ask? Glendora, yes. Question, did you see movie clips on that tape? DiGiulio, note my objection. We have been over that several times. Evans, Mrs. Buell, it doesn't matter if there were movie clips or not. Glendora, I think that this guy is a liar. Ms. Glendora, I think that this guy is a liar. DiGiulio, objection to that statement? Do you have any relevant questions to ask this gentleman? Glendora, he said he could not recall under oath. Court, he did not testify to that. Glendora, it's in evidence. Judge, he didn't testify here about movie clips. He said he thought, even if he viewed every single word of that what which was on the tape and every one of your actions, that is not relevant to whether or not he had a legal obligation to return the tape to you and whether he lived up to what obligation or failed in it. Glendora, I think it is relevant whether he is telling the truth. DiGiulio, Your Honor, may we move on? Glendora, the court, yes, move on. Glendora, I think it's relevant whether he's telling the truth, don't you? Glendora, did you receive any messages from Franklin Buell? The court. About what? The judge says, about what? DiGiulio says, about what? Objection to the form of the question, Your Honor. Small claims is not a lawyer's turf. And Judge Sara Lee Evans should know that. That DiGiulio is doing everything he can to upset the trial. And he should keep his big mouth shut. This is between two people, and small claims is not a place for a lawyer to act the way DiGiulio is acting. Mr. DiGiulio, about what? Objection to the form of the question, Your Honor. Judge, please make it more specific. Glendora, that's very specific. Did you ever receive messages from Franklin Buell? DiGiulio, at what time, Your Honor? May we have a time frame on that? Glendora, I am tired of him asking that. DiGiulio, objection. The court, ma'am, he is a lawyer and he is doing his job. Glendora, Your Honor, small claims is pro se for litigants, not lawyers. And I'm getting my opportunity to question this witness, and this lawyer interrupts all the time and answers. Question to Gelman, I want to know, did you receive any messages from Franklin Buell? DiGiulio, Your Honor. Glendora, it is a simple question, yes or no. Judge, during what time frame, Mrs. Buell? Glendora, no. Then the question would be too all over the place, and that's been the criticism of the questions. Judge, no, no, no. During what time frame? Between 1989 and 1990, between 1990 and 1991? Glendora, if he answers no, what do I know he is answering to? DiGiulio, the question posed is objectionable. Shut your mouth, DiGiulio. Glendora, I want to know if he received any messages at any time. Judge, to the extent you remember, did you ever receive a message from Franklin Buell? Gelman, your husband? Glendora, did you ever receive a message? Judge, it doesn't matter whose husband, a Franklin Buell. Gelman, the messages I remember getting over the years have been from Glendora. Question, Glendora says, did you receive any messages from Franklin Buell over the years? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection. Judge, I am going to allow it. It is not relevant, I know. Answer to the last question. I don't recall receiving any from Franklin Buell, but I am not saying he did not leave any. Glendora, what messages did you receive from Glendora? Gelman, I received repeated messages that Glendora wanted me to send her $120 for her videotape. Glendora, did you receive any messages that Glendora wanted her videotape returned? Gelman, yes. Glendora, did you answer any of those messages? Gelman, at the beginning I told them to tell Glendora that we sent the tape back and we were not interested in using the tape and we sent it back, okay? Glendora, which tape? Gelman, there is only one tape that I am aware of other than from the claims made here. There is only one tape that I am aware of, the one that was given to me. Glendora, are you telling the truth? Gelman, yes, I am. Judge, let's wrap this up, please. It's getting late. Glendora, did you ever receive messages saying Glendora asked you to call her? DiGiulio, haven't we stipulated that there were several requests for $120? Glendora, did you receive any messages? Please call Glendora. Gelman, the messages were a demand for money. Glendora, yes or no? Did you receive any messages? Please call Glendora. Gelman, yes. Finally. Finally, he told the truth. Glendora, did you call Glendora? DiGiulio, he answered that question, Your Honor. Glendora, I object. Judge, I am sorry, but I am overruling your objection. Mr. Gelman did not call Glendora. He testified to that. We know that. Glendora, no, he didn't testify to that, Your Honor. Court, Judge, did you call Glendora? Gelman, no, I did not. Now see all you have to go through? You know, he could have just answered simply the truth, and he had to go through all that. All those convolutions to get him to tell the truth. Glendora, now, why did you never return Glendora's call? DiGiulio, objection to the question, Your Honor. Judge, sustain. Glendora, why? Judge, because it doesn't matter. Glendora, objection. I take exception to that ruling. Judge, okay. Glendora, I want to know why you didn't return my call. DiGiulio, objection. Judge, I have already sustained your objection. How many times did you receive messages, Glendora asked? Please call Glendora. Gelman, numerous times. Glendora, numerous, meaning 10? Gelman, I don't know. I don't know. I don't recall. I don't know. I don't call. Recall. Glendora, and this is what Judge Sarah Lee calls credible testimony. Glendora, 20, 100. Judge, he said he doesn't know. Please move on. Gelman, numerous times. Glendora, what is numerous? 2, 3, 60? DiGiulio, Your Honor, this is getting out of hand. She is badgering the witness. Judge, Mrs. Buell, you may not ask the question again. The witness stated he doesn't know. He said numerous, that's all. Now move on, but the witness is lying. Now move on, and we are about to end the hearing, so ask any pertinent question. Glendora, I take exception to that ruling. Judge, okay, do you have any other questions? Glendora, I feel the same way my husband does. If I had any other questions, I wouldn't get a chance to ask him, and I wouldn't get any answers. Judge, notwithstanding your feeling, do you have any pertinent questions to ask? Glendora, you will have to wait. I am going to look at my notes. Glendora, did you return the Glendora tape? Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. Court, sustain. You may proceed. Glendora, Mr. Gelman, that at all times hereinafter mentioned, were you and are you now a resident of the borough of Manhattan, city and county and state of New York? Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. What does that have to do with anything? Court, sustained. It has no bearing on the case. Glendora, did you receive the subpoena that Mr. Buell tried to serve you upon you to appear in court? DiGiulio, objection. The witness is here. Shut up, DiGiulio. Glendora, no, to appear in court on November 1st, 1994. DiGiulio, Your Honor, I object. The witness is here. Small claims is not a lawyer's turf. It's a pro se's turf. And Big Mouth DiGiulio is answering all the questions that I'm asking Gelman. And Judge Sarah Lee Evans says that's okay. Glendora, did you receive that subpoena? DiGiulio, note my objection. Judge, Mrs. Buell, the witness is here. Glendora, to appear on November 1st, 1994. Judge, Mrs. Buell, ask another question. Isn't that terrific? Glendora, I take exception to that ruling. Judge, good, fine. Your exception is noted. Please continue. Glendora, what is your idea to settle? Was it your idea to settle? Glendora asked Gelman. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. Judge, sustain. You may not ask about settlement. Glendora, I take exception. Court, your exception is noted. Glendora, to that ruling. Glendora, did you hire Mr. DiGiulio to represent you? Mr. DiGiulio, note my objection, Your Honor. Glendora, court, I will allow it. Well, what do you know? Gelman, yes. Yes, he hired Mr. DiGiulio to represent him. Glendora, why did you wait until the Friday before the first court appearance to engage an attorney? Mr. DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. Judge, sustain. Nothing to do with the case. Oh, yes, it is. Because at the first hearing, that was their excuse for not having an answer, that they didn't have time, that they were only retained on Friday. I want to know why Gelman waited until Friday before the Monday before the first hearing to retain him. But Judge Evans is not going to do this justly. Evans says, do you have any other questions about the tape? Glendora, has anybody stolen anything from you? DiGiulio, objection, Your Honor. Judge, sustain. Glendora, okay, I state that I am not allowed to get the information that I should have. Judge, I am sorry that you feel that way. I tried very hard to give you ample opportunity to air your case. Glendora, I state I have not had the opportunity to present my evidence. I was denied my log, I was denied my audio tape, and was denied questioning the defendant. Judge, okay, do you have anything else you want to say? Glendora, I would like to point out to the court, and this is not my closing argument, but I would like to point out to the court that I was not sent $13.80 for travel expenses to produce the subpoena deuces tecum. I was not presented with it. Judge, there's nothing in the law that requires that. Glendora, in the small claims book I read, they have to pay 23 cents a mile, and I live in White Plains. Judge, you are here for your case. Glendora, no, I produced that, pointing. Judge, was that subpoenaed? Glendora, it was subpoenaed. DiGiulio, the only claim here, there, was a recording of Mr. Gelman making a promise of a subpoena. Of something, and then the court stenographer goes all wacky here. Of a subpoena was served, but apparently the tape does not exist. Glendora, he didn't say that. He said to produce all papers. He stated in his testimony and his questions here tonight to produce all papers, all records, and all tapes. Judge, that was $13 and how much? Glendora, it's 60 miles and it's 29 cents a mile. Judge, if I round it off to $14, would that be okay? Glendora, it's okay with me, Your Honor. Judge, go ahead. DiGiulio, statutory fees were paid, subpoena was paid. Glendora, just the $15, not the travel expenses. DiGiulio, I have copies of the checks. Glendora, I don't have any checks. DiGiulio, this is now an issue.
Rally day, June the 19th, 1995, Monday. Time is 8:46 a.m. Rally is scheduled from 9 to 11 a.m. This is the County Courthouse Plaza, Westchester County, New York. Are you ready? Faster than an elevator. The seat of injustice. This is a chat with Glendora. 15 minutes, we will show you the route. Fade out. Lincoln, just going into the judge's entrance. The New York State Court officer didn't push the button for him. I gotta tell you a joke that the New York State Court officer told me once a couple of years ago. He said, what do you call a lawyer with an IQ of 50? A judge. This is the sheriff's department over here, and this is the walkway. From the low-rise building, so-called. That's the county clerk's office up there in that corner, right there. Okay. Take care. Okay. Bye-bye. Who knows very well we have a permit and is trying to make trouble. The time is 9 a.m. The date is June the 19th, 1995, Monday. Okay, Dan, will you show him the permit?
Did we show him?
No, would you? It's right on the back of here. It's all. This is the city one.
Okay.
Okay, here's the permit. Don't let it out of your hand. Don't let it out of your hand. What?
Let me see the whole permit, please.
Let go of it.
Is there a back to it?
Yeah. So he's just trying to make trouble. Now he's dashed because we have a permit. There's a permit.
To see what it states.
Okay, let's watch this. What's your name, officer? He won't give his name. And he just called for a supervisor. Down with New York State court officers.
Get the
police back.
I would show it to an officer the first time he asked for it.
Oh, you did show it to him the first time he asked for it.
Can you just turn this over?
Yeah.
Keep your hands off of it, officer.
It's one-sided.
Thank you.
You got to come up for sound.
And do everything he can to stop the rally against these bad judges. 1, 2, 3, 4, we won't take it anymore. 5, 6, 7, 8, whom do we investigate? The judges, the bad judges. Permit, do your homework and stop wasting our time. New York State court officers. Bring the police officers back. New York State court officers are arrogant and nescient. Okay, that's enough. That's enough. You've been through it once.
It's only for one person. So
that's not what it's about at all. And you just go check it out with the county, big mouth. Go check it out with the county, big mouth.
Associated with this. Huh?
Put that down, I told you. Don't touch it. It's not yours. Get your hands off of it. This guy's trying to make trouble.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
No, you can't help me at all.
No, nobody can.
This says your name, ma'am. That's all.
You go check it out with the county department. He doesn't know what he's talking about.
That is abusive. Because a demonstration can be sponsored by one person, but as many.
But he wouldn't know that. They don't know anything about the laws.
I've never seen a permit required.
So go check it out.
Every demonstrator's name on a permit.
I believe it is.
That's you believe it is. You don't know me.
Authority, sir. Mr. 2925.
I said I believe so. That's
what I said. Verify with your office because otherwise.
That's what I was told in the beginning.
Yeah. Well, you were told. Well, you were told wrong.
Demonstrate because the. Hours from 9 to 11 have been allotted to a demonstration.
That is totally abusive.
Yes, it is totally abusive. Totally abusive. Look, we got things to to do, okay? Well, he's wrong about that. Sir, have a flyer.
What you doing?
Have a flyer, sir.
Behave yourself.
Down with Ingracia. Oh. Down with crooked judges. The bullhorn has to go here, Harvey. Oh, I'm sorry, we can't have
where?
Polls. I should have told you.
Can't have polls?
No, the petition says no sticks.
You got a pot.
The First Amendment to the Constitution, right here, sir. The First Amendment to the Constitution. You're allowed a petition.
Go ahead, Marie.
Look at this. Look, they're coming from all sides. Look at this. You can't believe it. All the guys with guns.
Yes, sir. We have a sign from.
And this isn't on your territory. Get off of it. This belongs to the city of White Plains.
Hold on. Oh,
this belongs to the city of White Plains.
We have a sign permit, sir.
What did you say?
I said this belongs to the city of White Plains, dummy.
Oh, okay.
Don't look for that, but bring that out.
It's what it's all about, folks. Rip off city.
Hi, Gene. You're wrong. They specifically said the Courthouse Plaza, and this is the Courthouse Plaza. Elena! Dan, come back! They are wrong! They specifically said the Courthouse Plaza.
Uh-huh.
So bring it back, they are wrong!
Hi.
Hi.
How you doing?
Where are you from?
In it.
Oh, hi.
Huh.
Property?
You don't need it, sir.
You don't?
No.
You do.
You don't.
Yes, ma'am.
And they told me that you don't.
Why is Westchester County the only place you got a right?
Get the badge numbers. Which is the right I have to take to the stock.
No bullhorns, loudspeakers, or other electronic devices.
He's not on the county property, and we have a permit for a bullhorn.
Ma'am, you're being very rude to me.
Why not?
Please don't be rude.
Because you're nasty to us and violating our rights.
How would you be rude?
You are violating my rights is what you are, and you're also biased. You're also biased. Harvey, okay, get your bullhorn.
Get
your bullhorn over here. I got his number.
Right here.
Get the car number 1442. Westchester Police.
Get it on.
Okay.
What are they so afraid of? What are they so afraid of? What are you afraid of? We are here under the First Amendment to the Constitution. The First Amendment to the Constitution. You are entitled to petition the government for redress of grievances.
Down with Colabella.
Who?
Judge Colabella. Down with Judge Colabella.
Down with Judge Colabella. They don't like it. They're afraid of us. What are they afraid of? Look how they're afraid of, ladies and gentlemen. Look what they're afraid of. A bunch of middle class
Gannett? Yeah, that's it. They won't talk to Gannett.
Why won't you talk to the newspapers? Talk to the newspapers. Get the reporters here. Get the television cameras here. They don't like us. Whatever you like us.
Oh, wait. I gotta go pull my friend.
We are here based on this document. We
freedom of speech, freedom of press, 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 freedom of press.
Headquarters to First Amendment.
So what we're going to have to get is a reading on the film, on the camera.
Freedom of press, freedom of press. What is your name, officer?
No law respecting an establishment.
What is your name?
You hear that? No law.
Freedom of press! Freedom of press!
Congress shall make no law!
This was signed by your superior, officer. This was signed by your superior.
He seems to be giving a good report in.
No, he says he wants a copy of the film.
Of the what?
He says he wants a copy of the film. I want to see Gannett.
All right, as long as we understand each other.
Okay, the time now is 9:43 a.m. This is at the 19 Floors of Injustice, the Westchester County Courthouse, on June the 19th, 1995, Monday, rally day. Sir, against boorishness. Is there a law against
boorishness? No, let's.
Just wanted to give it to you. If you can get it in, fine. Because it shows the national press.
I'm going to have a 7-mile caption as it is.
Okay. Well, listen, there might be trouble here because these people are dumb. We've had these confrontations in Suffolk County and Nassau. They came back to us. They don't bother us.
Conspiracy against the human condition. The war of the judges against humanity. The war of the judges. They declared war against us. War! 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 This is what's happening. Hitler is dead. Hooray, hooray. The Third Reich lives. Boo, boo. This is what we've got to worry about. The Third Reich, it's right here and it's alive and well. And Ito, Judge Ito and his Asian experts and other janissaries, they're going to re-enslave O.J. Simpson, even though he wasn't there. The gloves didn't fit. The whole fairy tale was made up by Furman and other gangsters in the DA's office, including Marsha Clark.
Didn't put any finger on you, but if you put a finger on him, you go to jail too.
Oh, he won't do that.
Everything's equal.
Oh, I know.
Can you beat that?
He said he's not a Christian.
We're getting their goat. They don't like us. Why don't they like us? We're getting their goat.
I heard him, and we're all adults.
It wasn't at the lawyer.
No. Hi, ma'am. How are you today?
You look marvelous in that outfit.
Did you ever see her on television?
No, sir.
She's got a television show on Friday nights. Comes from Long Island.
I don't get Long Island television.
No, no. In White Plains, Carl says it's 9 p.m. TCI. TCI, White Plains, 21 Town.
9 a.m. to 11 a.m. against the county of Westchester County Courthouse, 19 floors of injustice, on June the 19th, 1995, Monday.
This racket has gone on from 2:30 this afternoon, June the 20th, 1995, Tuesday, until 3:40 this afternoon. Hey, this has gone on from 2:30, as I told you, and now it's 4:47. That's 2 hours and a quarter, June the 20th, 1995, Tuesday. These are the girls in 3C. And also 4D. They are a nuisance. From 2:30 to 5 o'clock, it's 2.5 hours, he's screaming kits from 3C and from 4D. It's the black-haired one from 3C, he screams all of the time. The noise is still continuing. Our right to hold in peace.
Pass me the thing. Pass me the
thing. Unabated since 2:30 this afternoon. These girls live in 3C, and 2B, and 4D. We have a right to enjoy our home in peace and quiet.
Mommy.
2 p.m. I want you to listen to the peace to which we are entitled. This went on from 2:30 to 6 o'clock. That's 3.5 hours. And it's a violation of our rights. Now this is the way it should be. See, we can't even hear the church chimes. at 6 o'clock. Chat with Glendora as to what happened on Saturday, the, what would that be now? Today is the 22nd, so the 21st, 20th, 19th, 18th, 17th. On Scott Lord, we have nothing to report. Scott Lord is dormant until Labor Day. It's in the New York State Court of Appeals waiting for them to give me leave to appeal the lousy and illegal decision of the Appellate Division, Second Department. So that brings us up to Cablevision and what's happening on Cablevision 1. Well, first of all, the log did get out this week, and I'll give you the stats on that. Here's copies of my speech at the Cablevision annual meeting, which I will be telling you about. The hours on Cablevision the week of June the 12th were 8 hours. We spent $4.24 on Cablevision. The Cablevision pages are up to 9,092 bad pages of bad record. This is the log that went out. We haven't heard anything from Cablevision on the discovery demands that I read you and that we made. And included in the log, Robert Perry's brilliant opposition to Kalaji's statements about the Alliance decision. Alliance for Community Media. Tuesday was the Cablevision annual meeting. I started packing for it around 7:30. I packed up all the papers and the video camera and the audio recorder, queued it up and everything. And at 8, and then I got dressed up for it. And at 8 a.m., I pulled out, went down the Mamaroneck, the Hutchinson River Parkway, the fog, I-95, the country's worst, most dangerous road, and crossed it and went down to 295 over the Frog's Neck Bridge, or maybe that's 695. Anyway, over the Frog's Neck Bridge, Fog's Neck Bridge, and then down the Clearview to the Northern State. And there was a huge tie-up at where you enter at that very point that I told you. One goes to the Grand Central Parkway and one goes to the Northern State. And it was a huge tie-up. And then at Glen Cove, there's always a tie-up. For years, there was a tie-up because of the construction. And now the construction is gone and done. And the place is still tied up. But there was a great big tractor trailer that I guess should never have been on the Northern State. And how can you ever tell? I was told the Northern State is a parkway, and I said, well, with the English language, nobody can ever tell. You drive on a parkway and you park on a driveway. So there was this huge tractor trailer, and the rear end of it had fallen out, and the non-driver side, which would be the passenger side in a car, that had fallen over, and there was debris all over the side of the road, and there were three road maintenance trucks there and a policeman and somebody else. So that was the cause of that tie-up. And then it sped along, and of course I came to all the Oyster Bay roads. This is about the sixth time this happened to me, and I took the wrong one. So I got to a woman's down at a bank, and a woman was standing in line at the drive-in. I
said, how do you get to Cablevision? And she says, you take Jericho Turnpike, go right through the bank, take Jericho Turnpike, take three lights, and it's there on the right. And once I saw the police station for the second district, or whatever you call it, second precinct or something, I knew where I was. I got there at 9:25. It took an hour and 35 minutes to get there. There wasn't any parking. I parked in a visitor spot, and I unloaded all the things from the Lincoln, and the word was out, Glendora was on the property, so that when I came in the door, there was the head of security, Mr. Astor Reeder, and he looked utterly handsome. He really looked good. He had on a very fine suit and a nice shirt and tie, of course, shoes and socks. He just looked like $1 million. They are $1 million out there. But anyway, I was glad to see him. And he said he liked my blue jacket. And then he offered, I told the two women at with the table at the door blocking everybody that I was Glendora and I was a shareholder. And they didn't say a thing. Remember this year, last year, what time they gave me? And so Mr. Astorita says, can I help you carry any of your things upstairs? And so he escorted me up to the conference room. And I'm telling you, the conference room is no bigger than your living room. It's way too small. And there were 40 people there. And two people in the back were taking statistics. It was some kind of a law. And then I sat down with two people and I talked to them. And I gave one of them a copy of the annual report. He was a stockbroker. He was very interested in that. And then his client was sitting next to him. And so I got through about 10 or 15 minutes. The meeting started on time at 10 o'clock. And it was conducted by James Dolan. Where was Charles Dolan? In Alaska. I don't think that's right. The rules say that the chief executive officer shall preside at the annual meeting. And where was Patrick Dolan? In Alaska. Now that's not right. That is, in a word, crooked. I'm just back from Judge Colabella's court and the appellate division. And so picking up where we left off, everything was scripted, folks. They had a script for everything. I brought home a copy of the script. Isn't that awful? To be so, well, dehumanized is the word. Okay, and so James Dolan, the son, he looks quite a bit like his father. Well, hello, Katie. Well, what an honor to have you here, Katie. We are so proud to have you. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. What a great Katie. And so they went through everything very routinely and rigidly and more like robots than human beings. And it would be nice, Katie. Got the microphone out of the drawer. And so they voted for their, everything was scripted, all the people, all of the motions, all of the seconds were all scripted. There's nothing spontaneous about it. And so they voted for their accountants and they voted for their directors routinely. And when the directors were called, not one of them stood up and turned around and faced the people at all. They just sat there like robots in their seats. The coffee and refreshments were late. They never got there. But Mr. Cass brought us each in a Danish. It was delicious, utterly delicious, a little Danish like that. Delicious. What else happened, Katie? You weren't there exactly. You're not a shareholder. They had quite a few precautions about people asking questions or people speaking. Oh, and this was a queer thing, that if you had a company about, if you had a question about the company, you could make your question. But if you had a question about yourself, you had to wait until afterwards to talk it over with one of the officers or directors. So it came time for questions, and I certainly put up my hand, and a man over there put up his hand, and Mr. James Dolan took the man over there, and the man over there was a shareholder, and he did ask about Boston, Cablevision of Boston. It was a very well thought out question. And then questions again, and I put up my hand, and this time James Dolan recognized me. As I say, there were just 40 people. I was in the back row, and there were people standing behind me, and of course Mr. Astorita, Mr. Astorita was right there over my right shoulder. And so I was not going to read my speech with everybody's back toward me. So, that's too big a truck to be going up a residential street. The windows were all open because the temperatures the last 3 days were 93 and so forth. So when I rose and I went down and I said that I had, I went down and I stood in front of them right next to James Dolan. And there is no dais, there's a little enclosure and that's where James Dolan sat. And I went down and I faced the people and I said I had a 4-minute statement to make. And to the directors and to the officers and to what few shareholders there were. And it's a queer, I never saw an annual meeting like that. And so I did, and you know the speech, I read it to you before I went. Well, I read it exactly the way it was. I held up the exhibits that I didn't hold up for you, the New York Law Journal, the New York Times, the Newsday, the Westchester Law Journal 1, the Westchester Law Journal 2. And just the way I'd given it to you. And it went just the way theirs went, scripted and clockwork. And I had to, they gave me no table or anything, so as I showed them the New York Law Journal, I had to drop it on the floor, and the New York Times, I had to drop it on the floor. And then when I'd finished, right on time, 4 minutes, I bent over, and as I bent over, picking up my para and my Fresenius, I said, thank you for my hearing. And I went back to my seat. So that's good. Cablevision is tamed. They've learned how to act at an annual meeting, that you can't exclude a shareholder the way they did last year. They had to come clean. So they handled it very well, and the speech was mighty powerful. Of course, it won't make any difference. They'll go on being stupid, and they'll be gone, go on lying and covering up and elongating this matter instead of doing what the speech said they should do. Face it, we were wrong, we're sorry, let's atone, and let's get it over with. They will never do that. So the meeting was over indeed at 10:30 in its regimented way, militaristic way. And one other person asked a question, and his question was about, gee, it was interesting too. I've got it written down somewhere. I should have told you. And then Dolan stood up, and he said he was something-something Dolan, and this is my son Kevin, a teenager, about 15. And he asked about a trust, some kind of a Dolan trust, and boy, that was it. That was it. And then finally, the coffee and the refreshments did arrive, and they were terrific refreshments. They gave us a good party. It was really nice. And I wish to thank my hosts, Mr. Charles Dolan and the management of Cablevision. It was a delicious repast. A big bowl of fresh fruit, cantaloupe and grapes. And then bagels and coffee and orange juice and I guess tea. I don't know if there was any soda pop. And there was cream cheese with jelly in it. And that's the school bus. I'm afraid we're going to have to put down the window and do without the fresh air. You hear that, Katie? So I stayed and enjoyed the refreshments with Mr. Lancezera and with Mr. Cass and one of the women from who came up to do the statistics and to monitor it for somebody. Something that's probably required by the Securities Exchange Commission. And
This was surprising and very, very nice. A man came up, a very handsome man, with quite a red face, and he came up and he says, "Hello, Glendora, I'm William Bell." So that was nice. The rest of them should have done that. So I told him that I didn't know that he was that good looking. And if I'd known he was that good looking, I wouldn't have sued him, right? And so he went out into the hall, and I said, "Mr. Bell, do you remember that there's another person in Long Island, the same name that you have, same middle initial?" He says, "Oh, yes, I heard about that." So that's all over. And then Mr. Deitch came out and spoke. He's very good looking, too. And he asked what if I'd had a good trip out. And I said that there were the two tie-ups, and that's why I left at 8 o'clock. And Mr. Astorita talked to me, and then Mr. Astorita said, "I have to go to a meeting." And he says, "But I've asked Ken." He designated a person named Ken, a young man just starting out, to take care of me, to carry my things to the automobile. What this badge says is it says VOCO, Victims of Corruption in the Courts. Then what happened? Oh, and I asked David Deitch where he was born. He was born from Providence. And I told him how Providence was a great broadcast television to that city during the 1950s when television first started. He was interested to know that. Of course, he's too young to know that. But WJR-TV was owned by the Outlet Department Store, and their studios were in the Outlet Department Store. And but it was one of the TV giants when it first started up. And then how WPRO came into being by Thomas Murphy as Cap Cities. That was the beginning of Thomas Murphy, who ended up buying ABC Television Network. And he wanted to know how I knew so much about Providence, and I said, one of my first television programs was on Boston, WBZ-TV, the Westinghouse station, and that we lived in Springfield, man. Oh. So after that, we finished around 10:45, 10:50, and we all went downstairs after having our repast, and Ken took my things to the car, and I talked to Mr. Cash and to Mr. Lancisera. And at 11 a.m., I left, and boy, the roads were wide open. It was nice, speed right along. Not any more than 55, of course. I disapprove of the new speed limit, 65. I think 55 is plenty enough. It kills too many people, and it kills too many animals who get in the road. And I was at the Scarsdale Post Office, I would say, by in an hour at noon. So that was a Cablevision annual meeting, and I sum it up as saying that Cablevision has been tamed. They now know how to act at an annual meeting. You have to hear the shareholders' viewpoint. That's Cablevision 1. Now, what's happened there? We are still waiting for Judge Bryant's erudite and scholarly decision on these very important matters. Was Glendora's freedom of speech and freedom of press violated? Did Cablevision violate the Title 47 of the United States Code 531E, no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel? 2, if they did, does Glendora have a private right to enforce it? So we're still waiting for Judge Bryant's decision. It's not like Judge Bryant to take this long. Judge Bryant gets out a decision the next day or the same day, 20 minutes after the court appearance. On Cablevision 2, by the way, Judge Bryan is the United States District Court, where he had the case in the first place and just sloughed it off, and I appealed it, and the United States Court of Appeals, Second Circuit, says, no, you can't dismiss a pro se case unless beyond a doubt, it's proven beyond a doubt she doesn't have a case. And so they sent it back to they vacated Judge Bryan's decision, it's no good anymore, and they sent it back to him. That means remanded. Okay, now what else? So Cablevision 2, you knew that the appellate division granted my motion for surreply, and that Kalaji and Cablevision haven't answered my surreply, or haven't made a motion to have
to answer my SIR reply. You knew that the appellate division didn't help me out at all when it comes to the crooked thing that Silverman did, the gag order, the rob me of my costs order, first one, and then the second one robbed me of my course, my costs, so that the sheriff's department and the bad judges, Judge Silverman, and it looks like the appellate division is all in collusion. We're all together. We're all together. It looks like a conspiracy, you know, against justice. It's too bad. It's too bad. That's why we wear the badge, victim of corruption in the courts. So that's, and I haven't written my protest to that. And then, I don't think there's anything else. Oh, yes. I have to read you some more things from the annual report. Okay. One time, Cablevision got out a very fancy annual report, a very fancy cover, pictures of Tata and Dolan. It was nice. So now they're talking about Cablevision of Boston, Cablevision of Chicago, Cablevision of Newark, U.S. Cable. Remember that U.S. Cable is Cablevision. AR Cable Partners, that's the old Adams Russell systems. What's this? The company conducts its programming activities through Rainbow Programming, its wholly owned subsidiary, and through subsidiaries of Rainbow Program. And that's what James Dolan is, the president of Rainbow Holdings, Inc. They change the name every year, like Scott Lord. In partnership with certain unaffiliated entities, including National Broadcasting Company and Telecommunications Incorporated. That's TCI. That's TCI. How are they related to unaffiliated entities? Rainbow Programming also owns an interest in Courtroom Television Network and in Madison Square Garden. Rainbow Programming Sports Channel services provide regional sports programming to the New York market, the Philadelphia market, New England, Chicago, Cincinnati, Cleveland, San Francisco, and Florida. American Movies Classics is another one. Rainbow Programming and NBC formed a venture to exploit the pay-per-view television rights to the 1992 Summer Olympics. Rainbow Programming share of the losses of the venture amounted to its maximum obligation of $50 million, and this payment was made to NBC in January 1993. Liberty Media Corporation. Now that's not Liberty Cable TV, which is a competitor to the cable companies, and I'm all for them. The company is considering possible transactions that could result in Rainbow Programming